far greater reserves that we can sustain us to give the workfare to the lower income workers who are laid off, to actually increase spending, to actually shore up the economy. So we actually ride through the crisis very well. And what is the reason for this? And what is it that we have this amount of reserve? It is because of a thinking cabinet, a thinking prime minister, and a thinking finance minister. And so that is very important. Now, let me present to you a Western and a Chinese concept of thinking. The Western concept of thinking, I call it ABCD. Right? A is analytical. Western concept of thinking is step by step. You solve a problem step by step. Yeah? You are given a thinking model, thinking tools, and which will bring you through a theory in which you can solve problems in a more efficient way. Behaviorist. Now, behaviorist is a kind of a school of philosophy that looks at how you can modify behavior through rewards and punishments. So if you are a student in school and the teacher is not very happy with your behavior, the teacher will use rewards, extrinsic rewards, to say, if you behave well, you will get to have a certain reward. Okay, for example, 10 minutes earlier you can go to recess. Or you can change the behavior patterns by perhaps some counseling, telling them, okay, if you change your behavior, you'll be rewarded in certain ways. So it is the Western concept of thinking actually has some influence from the behaviorist school. But this is not a very saleable. Actually, the cognitive psychology became more popular in the 1980s onwards. And so what cognitive psychology says that our mind is an information processing model. That means we are like a computer. We process information step by step. We process all the information, we gather that, and then we see what is the best solution. So that is a cognitive psychology influence that it has on Western thinking. Last, it is discrete. Discrete means you break things apart. So if you are given a problem, you break it apart into manageable portions. Let me ask you a question for those how do you eat an elephant? Tell me, how do you eat an elephant? Can you eat the whole elephant? Huh? What? Say again?
Press the button.
Cut it. Thanks. Okay, Kevin, you say something? How do you eat an elephant?
Cut it.
Very good. Yeah, you cut it up into small pieces, right? So this is what the discrete, you know, when you think about thinking is discrete, it is breaking down a problem which is very massive into a small manageable size. And this is what Western concept of thinking always likes to do. Break things down into a small part and you can solve it. So all this is very, what I call, very scientific. It is quite scientific. Now, if you were to see a book that is written about reasoning or critical thinking, which I borrowed from the library, I borrowed quite a number of books, and you can take a look at the elements of reasoning, and you can see, perhaps, Caleb, would you like to take a look at it? And you tell me, how do you think that if you are able to study this, would you be a better thinker? Or if you can pass it a book around, you see that this book looks like a manual. It's full of rules, syllogism, and a lot of very abstract things. And I wonder if, as parents, would you ask your children to learn critical thinking and reasoning through a book like this, which is so abstract and so difficult to understand? And this is what I call the information processing model, you know, how the Western perceive thinking in a very step-by-step method, saving things through the five senses and processing it. And this sculpture by Rodin is actually the typical, or in fact, the paramount thinker. In fact, this sculpture is called the thinker. He's sitting there thinking very hard about problems and, you know, perhaps the world's problems. Right, so now, turning to the next. What is the Chinese conception of thinking? Now, if you look at this word, how do you read this word? Si, right? So, for the Chinese students, I have a group of Chinese students there, right? Is that correct? 你们是从中国来的是吗? 所以那个思想啊, 我用一些华语啊, 因为有没有其他的? 你思想, 这个思, 这个上面是什么一个心,对吗? 所以心是代表什么呢? 心,我们的 heart, 可是不是那个内脏,那个心呢? 是代表我们的整个人的一个状态,对吗? 一个态度。 So, it is our represent not just the brain, the mind, mental, cognitive part of us, but really the whole person, the whole soul and spirit. And so, the Chinese conception of thinking is really more effective, it is more about feelings. It is more holistic, it looks at the bigger picture rather than discrete things. It is more relational, which means to say, it considers other people. Okay, we talk about filiality. The filiality is really the root of Confucianism, and it is about knowing your place in society, honoring your parents, your authority, the people in the authority, the government, and so on. And very much about values. Okay, so in the Chinese conception of thinking, it's very much about value system. So, and if you look closely, so you can see that the heart that sees, can you see the two eye? Yeah? So, 那个字,那个心啊,是可以,是有眼睛的 So it is a more holistic kind of understanding of thinking. And if you look at this 田啊, 田是,你们摘田, it's a cultivated field. It is a field that is not like a wild grass growing up. It is cultivated. So imagine the cultivation of mind. So the, can you see that the word itself in thinking or in what we call 思想 is very actually holistic and concentrates a lot more on the whole affective, emotional value thing that we don't see in the West. Now, this is not just the words itself. Let's look at Mengzi actually says that the heart is understood as neither the bodily heart nor soul, but mind with sensitivity. And that thinking sums up the function of the heart. The organ of the heart can think, but it will find the answer only if it does think. Otherwise, it will not find the answer. And he even talks about the four states of heart: benevolence, righteousness, propriety, and wisdom. So, can you see that the rule of thinking in the Chinese, in terms of the words, origins, as well as the philosophy, is very much about not just the head, but also the heart. So now, let's look at the consequence if we disregard the heart. We don't think about heart, we just think about the head, knowledge. Now what is this? Subprime mortgages. Now what is subprime mortgages? Basically, you have this particular cartoon which shows a house tittering at the cliff, support, being laid upon with all the banks, brokers, securities, and so on. And this is a person who has bought a home, who actually could not afford it. This is in America. 2008 and 2009, where actually they said, I thought we were just buying a house, but you can see all the houses are dropping off. So what's the issue? What's the problem here? Now what's foreclosure? Foreclosure is where you earn, you lend a lot of money from the bank, you cannot pay the installment, the bank takes back your home. So you know that almost 1 million American homes were foreclosed. That means given back to the bank. A lot of people were left without homes in America. So this is why that happened in 2009 and this led to the financial crisis that hit Singapore as well. So the Americans are very angry at that time. And they were of course in the state of the unemployment and they elected President Obama into office, okay, hoping that he can turn the tide.